I'm stuck to that chair. I don't find my mouse. If someone sees it,
okay.
So the computer, not the real, not the real one.
Happy?
Ah, yeah.
There we go. Okay. I will move away now. Okay, Daniel. I think the room is a little large and these walls absorb sound, so please do keep the volume as you go.
Okay, so my name is Daniel. I work for a company called Spool. It's we are a streaming company, OTT company, and we stream Bollywood content around the world. So obviously, like, to stream content around the world, you're like a big user of CloudFront. That's actually our main cost in AWS is CloudFront. Okay, so we deliver video on any kind of device, mostly on Android and iOS devices, tablet phones, also on laptop, desktop, and connected TVs. So as I said, it's really like it's not targeted to one country, it's targeted worldwide, which makes the problem a bit harder. So especially when you have people in this region here that have like tiny, tiny internet connections, it becomes a tough job. Okay, so to send that to everyone, we decided to use only HLS, so to focus on only one format instead of starting to try out different formats depending on platform, because when we started Spool, we were like 4 or 5 tech guys, and there was one company in the world that said to us, you have to use HLS. So we stick with that for other devices too. So for those who don't really know HLS, it's kind of an interesting format. You have like a master file that describes your content, in which you can put different renditions, which each rendition has a different quality, be it on screen size, on bandwidth, on compression. What is interesting to us is mostly the bandwidth. So the devices will automatically switch from one rendition to another depending on what bandwidth it's available to them. So it means that normally, if everything works right and well, the user will just get the best quality he can get with his actual internet connection. But that's the theory. So every one of these renditions has then a list of segments, which are like tiny chopped movie segments, generally about 10 seconds. And it's just pointing to every one of these TS segments, which is a part of the movie. So that's what I just explained. So the player will try to fetch the 4000K content. If he can't, because his download speed is only 980, he will switch down to the 164K rendition and get something more grainy, more pixelated, but the movie should never buffer, actually. So the first question is, where do you want to store and how do you want to serve this kind of content? So the storage, if you work with Amazon, I think it's pretty obvious. It will be S3. Then, how to deliver that? First question, should you deliver directly out of S3? I think most people nowadays know that it's really not a good idea. First, S3 is really slow. And second, S3 is only in one point in the world. So if you have your S3 bucket in the US and you want to get a file to Singapore, you have to download from US to Singapore. And all of you that like try to open websites in the US on a Sunday evening, you know how painful that could be. So the question, so the real stuff that I think anyone does is use CloudFront to serve that with the file directly into S3. But CloudFront is still not good enough. So yeah, I should have put in not why, but how come? So CloudFront not good enough, how, why? So there are a few stuff that, like, as an end user, you look at CloudFront, you say, why don't they do that? Why don't they allow me to change this feature or these parameters? So first, you run into this problem if you have something like HLS. It's a lot of tiny, tiny files. So one movie is about 4,000 files that range between a few hundred K a file to 6-7 megs a file. So it means that since we, if you have a lot of renditions, you mean that on every edge, a file will not be hit enough in one day, because some user will hit a good quality, some other user lower quality, and so on. So every file doesn't get enough hits to become relevant for the CloudFront algorithm. So at the end of the day, CloudFront will say, oh, this file is only 100K and was hit 200,000 times. It's not worth it. Throw it away and leave this huge MP4 file that has 20,000 hits, but it is a 2 gig file. Leave it in CloudFront. Leave it long in CloudFront, and the small files just throw it away to make room for something else. So that with that, we realized that actually the TTL we were doing for CloudFront, we went like just every file is like a 1 year TTL. Keep it in the cache for 1 year. That never worked. After 1 day or even a few hours, generally the files were gone from CloudFront. And once the file is no more in CloudFront, your big issue is that CloudFront will fetch again from S3. So if I take back my example before, your bucket is in US East Coast. You are in Singapore. You obviously hit the Singapore edge. The edge will fetch from Virginia. So actually, your bottleneck is no more your phone or your laptop connection. It's the connection between Singapore CloudFront to your Virginia edge. And this one is slow, regardless of how. And you can do nothing about it because it's not in your hand. So it means that every user will get these slow files. And well, one thing that happened for us a few years back, now it starts to get a little bit better, is you cannot rewrite headers. So for those of you who have worked with Varnish, just Varnish has these four components, like request in, request to backend, back from backend, back to users. On every part in Varnish, you are able to rewrite anything you want. In CloudFront, you have zero control. So you could actually not say, like, remove this header because it just adds a mess. So that's actually my next example is CloudFront will store differently if your client has the request accept encoding gzip. You will just say, oh, it's a compressed content. It's not the same answer I should give as a non-compressed. So you will store that in two different storage locations on CloudFront, even if the end file is never compressed. On a movie segment, you never compress it because it's already compressed due to your MP4, H.264, and all that. But it means that a browser that will, by default, add this header, and the phone that doesn't have it, a phone app, they will start to hit the same CloudFront edge, but use two different buckets on the edge, two different storage locations. So they're not even able to share the files that are already in CloudFront. So you will start to have like double storage, and your movie will be fast with a phone, but slow with a browser. One thing is hard, you cannot warm up CloudFront. So you have your 4,000 little files on S3. You put your movie live on your website. CloudFront is empty. So it means the first user or the first few users that come to your movie, they suffer, and then you generally get a bad tweet about it. So yeah, because the first user fetches from S3, obviously, then. And you cannot anticipate the next request. So on an HLS or even on an image gallery, if the user takes file A, you know that in 10 seconds he will want to have file B. And if you have a HLS or you have anything that's like sequential, you know the process, you should be able to tell CloudFront, hey, this guy is pulling this file, please start pull like the 10 next files already. And so, yeah. And generally, the S3 buckets are far away from your CloudFront edge. You have only one bucket that you generally put in US East because 3 years ago it was the cheapest, like way cheaper than Singapore. Now it's no more the case. And now you have bucket replication that help a bit. I'll come to that later. And so all this problem, what happens is since your player, you have to remember that since your player is choosing the rendition he has to take, he will get to one. He will perhaps be able to download it because it's in CloudFront. He will say, oh, I download this segment really fast. I can ramp up one better. But as soon as he ramps up to one better, it's no more in CloudFront. So it will be really slow. So, oh, I have a bad network. I go down again. And the next down is perhaps not in CloudFront either. And then it will go down again. And you end up finally with a really crappy video quality. Even if people are telling you on the support channels, I have a 10 Mbps line with my ISP, why can I not have like a really good movie? It's just because how the player works, it just like at every segment looks at the speed you are getting it and then decides to go like one higher, one lower. And if you're always fetching from US, then for sure it won't, you will never have something great. So a few things of all these problems, some points you cannot fix, some points you can work around. That's actually the magic of Amazon. It's you don't have access to everything, but you can like build stuff around to try to make it better. So first was the first thing we did was to warm up CloudFront. So what I did is I'm just for every movie I know the URLs because it's like I encoded them, so I know what name I gave them. So for every movie I create a list of all the movie segments. I found out somehow all the DNS names of every edge of CloudFront. And I'm just calling one by one. Curl, 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 curl. So, and that's just like a fleet of 20, 30 spot instances in every region that run with an SQS queue once it's finished, spot instance down. It's a few hundred bucks to do that. If it makes like 100 customers happy, it's worth it. I tried to start to do that in Lambda instead of having my spot instances. Yeah. Lambda, not that great for that kind of job. So I run into the timing issues of Lambda, like more than 1 minute it fails. Because I have really like, a movie is 4,000 files. You have 50 edge, so you make the map. It's really a lot. So I ended up now, I'm still running with Lambda. I just make a lot of small bunch of batch files running only in Virginia. I will need to start to move that like more around the globe once I can have Lambda a bit in more places. So then the interesting part is that if the S3 bucket is too far away, it's to use something like what we call CDN for CDN. So actually we put the CDN behind the CloudFront CDN. So we started to want to replicate that to every bucket in every region in the world. And then we realized it's on the cost level, it's too much. On the maintenance level, it's too much. Because you need to be sure that every file is everywhere. If one file is missing, the whole region, the movie doesn't work for one 10-second segment that's not there. And the other problem is that CloudFront can only access one domain. So you cannot tell the CloudFront, if you're in US East, access this bucket with this domain name. If you're in this region, access this bucket with this domain name. So you can access only one domain endpoint. And two buckets cannot have the same domain name because the bucket names are unique. So what we ended to do is we fired up EC2 instance in every region, put on them Nginx, and use the caching mechanism of Nginx to actually fetch objects from S3, put them in Nginx in the cache, and then have CloudFront pull out of this caching service. So for that, you would need like a custom-made Nginx build that is able to talk to a private S3 bucket. So if you don't want to make your bucket public, you have to add some key headers in to access the private files. So there's someone who made a plugin called AWSO for Nginx that allows you to do that like easily. Access key and secret into the config and giving the bucket names and the path you want to access to. I added to some Lua capabilities. Actually, I didn't. I used Lua because it was already there. And then at the end, it's still the end user. The user will still go to CloudFront, but instead of going directly to the S3 bucket, we use a Route 53 latency record to point every CloudFront edge to the nearest EC2 instance, which caches the content. And this EC2 instance will fetch from the S3 bucket. Like that. So it means that instead of having to fetch your file that is not in CloudFront from your US bucket, you will actually be able to fetch it from your fake S3 bucket that is an EC2 instance inside Singapore. which already you win quite a few seconds on that. So the benefit of using Nginx cache instead of full replication is you don't have to manage the full replication. It's just a cache, so it gets replicated when needed. If some files are never requested, you don't waste storage on them. And since there's an EC2 instance, you have an operating system behind, and with an operating system, even if managing server sucks, like you said, you can do stuff. You can toy around. So one issue with the Nginx cache is an EBS instance. An EBS is only 1 terabyte. I didn't want to start to manage multiple caches with Nginx, and so I just went the easy way. I spin up a LVM, and I start with a 1 terabyte. Once the 1 terabyte reaches 80%, there's a cron job that just checks that and adds another terabyte and expands the LVM instance. So at the end, I put a cap to manage cost. So now I think I am around like 6 terabyte maximum of some instance. And if the cache shrinks, but it doesn't shrink because you cannot hot shrink an LVM in partition. There's still one issue with all that, even if it works fine, is if you want some redundancy, you would have like multiple instances in each region. The problem is, since it's an EBS volume, you cannot share them between different instances. So if you have like 3 instances, 4 instances that run in one region, they will have all their own cache, and like with the random ELB connections, you won't know which one has, or perhaps sometimes it's in cache, sometimes it's not, so which is a bit not optimal. So, but I hope that Elastic File System will solve that. So where's Alex? We need Elastic File System quickly. Hopla, one too fast. That's the okay. So one other problem I had. So with that, I'm able to warm up my CloudFront. I'm able to move the content nearer to the CloudFront edge to anticipate the next request. So you know, if you take the 1928K first segment, there's a really high chance that in 10 seconds your client will request the second segment, or perhaps one higher, or perhaps one lower, but number two. So what we do is, when Nginx sees a request for segment one, we'll actually start to download already before the client requests it segment two of like the same rendition, one up and one down. So here, just one up and the same. And then same for once the segment two comes in, when the client requests for segment two, we'll start to download the next one and so on. So it means that as soon as the client gets to segment two, he doesn't have to fetch it from the end of the world. He can fetch it from something that's almost on the CDN. Taking too fast. Oh, let's pause. Is that the right one?
This one.
Ah, this one. So I started first to just say to Nginx, like, launch me a system command to download the other one. Then I realized that that's actually a blocking thing. So the client has to wait that to get segment one, he has to wait that segment one and two are downloaded, which doesn't really make sense. So I used something. I used the queue system to have it non-blocking. That's where the Lua script comes in. So when the first request comes in, I just send, with a Lua script, I call a system command that allows me to just store the current URL into a Beanstalk D host that runs on localhost. And then I have a Beanstalk C daemon that just reads every URL, split by the slashes, finds out which segment it is, build the new URLs with the next segment, one rendition up, one rendition down, and starts to do curls on that, which actually not curl in Python, man. Just downloads all the segments using localhost. So if I did that on localhost and not using SQS, it was just for a matter of speed. Like, I didn't want to have network calls going to outside of my instance, waiting, and then another process that waits, then calls again. Having everything on localhost was just to improve the speed of the whole process. And that's the part of things you can, the cool stuff you can do once you have access to an OS and be able to toy around with it. Okay, so I didn't dare to make a live demo. I was a bit busy today to build everything up. But I did some tests last week, just to have some number in case I wasn't able to do the demo. So I had a bucket in Virginia. The client was not in the AWS office at my home, but the bucket, the CloudFront Eng was Singapore. And I had an EC2 instance in Singapore. So if you see on the left one, it's just CloudFront directly to S3. So the transfer speeds for every segment, which are like 4 to 6 MBs, it's like in a range of 4 to 5 seconds. So with that, it's still okay, because remember, one segment is 10 seconds. So as long as the client has less than 10 seconds to download segment, you are good. So sadly, I have a too good internet line at home to make it work for real. But once it happens, and I have seen that even in Singapore, it's that suddenly the segment takes 20 seconds to download. At this point, the player will start to scale down and take something that's less good in quality. But the interesting part is, once I use this mid-tier servers, the first one is still the same speed. There's no change because the file is not in CloudFront, or not in my mid-tier server, and not in CloudFront, obviously. And then the second one is directly fetching from this mid-tier server and no more from my S3 bucket. And you see the jump in speed is, it's, I think numbers speak by themselves here. Well, it's lucky we're in Singapore. Singapore has a good network. Servers are in Singapore. So it's like, we're all a bit cheating in Singapore.
What is it? But there's like three steps. It is the fetching from your middle tier to CloudFront, and then the download from CloudFront. So that's the download speed.
That's the download speed from my computer at home.
Yeah, just from like CloudFront.
From CloudFront. But CloudFront, I made sure CloudFront was empty.
Yeah, but I was curious.
So once you have CloudFront, it's even like it's 0.2 here, something like that.
But can't you work out?
What I wanted to solve is worst case scenario: the files are not in CloudFront.
All right.
So that's what I'm trying to solve here.
I was interested to know what the speed was from CloudFront from your mid tier to CloudFront.
From CloudFront, it depends on which side you look. That really depends. So in Singapore, I think it should be like gigabyte or 10 gigs because it's in the same building. Okay. But if you look a customer that will be in Mumbai, he will go to the Mumbai Edge, hopefully. And the Mumbai Edge, his nearest EC2 instance for the Mumbai Edge is Singapore.
All right.
So then it's actually in these scenarios that this stuff is interesting. In Singapore, it's everything works. You could pull out directly from S3. You have no issue in Singapore.
So that speed 100 is a limit from your home connection, or what is it?
I think that's the limit of my EC2 instance.
Okay.
So you mean bandwidth?
It's a M4 large.
So it means your outbound bandwidth limit is 1.38 Mbps.
Yeah, so here it's at 100 Mbps here, because I think the bottleneck is the network, let's call it a network card, even if it's not a network card, but it's the network interface on my EC2 instance.
I thought EC2 was gigabit.
And just how fast is your home connection?
Like 1 gig? Like every Singaporean, no?
Yeah.
Has someone an internet speed lower than 1 gig here? It's a tech room, no? Like everyone is with.
I got 2 gigabits. So.
Yeah, that's. Yeah, I wanted to go to this one, but I had a wife at home then. For what for? So.
Feel free to catch me afterwards, and we can talk about EC2 instance networking as well.
I want to hear that too.
Okay. Okay. Guess I'm doing a talk on that then.
Yeah.
The question is actually what he's asking is, and I'm also interested on the same range, same area. So your test is with mid-tier, without mid-tier, right?
Yeah, so...
two testing that you
have. In both cases, there's cloud front.
Both cases actually have a cloud front. Only the mid-tier is not there.
Yes.
So one is actually is picking cloud front picking from S3. Another one is actually is picking from using the mid-tier to pick from S3.
Yes.
Right? So, but you know, if you notice that the either case as an end user, I'm using my home network connection.
Yeah.
So I'm hitting the cloud front, right? So the first time the files is there, not there, so it is taking a time to get that output. Subsequent time, the file is there, that's why it is faster, right? Either one of the case. So why there is a speed difference for this? How your mid-tier is helping pulling
because
files from your...
So in without mid-tier, if I follow my bytes from my curl command, I will go first to CloudFront. CloudFront will tell me, oh, I don't have this file. So CloudFront will go to my mid-tier, without mid-tier, will go to the S3 bucket and say, yeah, give me this file, the S3 bucket, yeah, okay. Come back to CloudFront and come back to my browser. So my bottleneck here is actually my speed between my Singapore CloudFront edge and my S3 bucket in Virginia. So the bottleneck is on this stretch. So it's not the speed between my home connection and CloudFront Singapore. I hope it's near my gigabit, else I blame my ISP for that.
The connection speed when you do internally in Singapore connections and then when you go outside, so if you're accessing something on S3 in US, the speed is not 1 gig completely.
Yeah, I got it, but I'm trying to understand it. So,
so in this one...
So just to be clear, the thing mid-tier is doing is predicting the next chunk and pre-caching that in CloudFront or at the mid-tier.
So which he has a caching component. It's not just the EC2 is doing the magic, it is the caching component.
No. What? Oh, yeah. So sorry,
right?
I wasn't clear enough. So what's magic here is actually that since I requested this file, my mid-tier server knows, oh, I will be requesting this one soon.
Yeah.
So while I'm downloading this one during my 4 seconds here, he's already fetching this one, which will take roughly about 4 seconds, something like 4 seconds, 40 minus, 4 seconds roughly. So when 10 seconds later I request this one, it's already in my EC2 instance in Singapore, so I don't have this bottleneck between Singapore and US anymore. I can go, I'm just local to Singapore this time.
Exactly, so which means your EC2, there is a cache component which actually are pulling using the prediction time, then
it is
going to...
So the magic here is because it prefetches stuff that are the most likely to be requested in soon. So that's...
The next question I have, you see this problem only with CloudFront? Don't see this problem with other CDN providers?
So actually I stole the whole idea. I hope there's nobody from Akamai here. I stole this whole idea from Akamai. Because we tried Akamai for a few months, and they had this magic thing somehow. They had two origins. And they had two origins. They had what they called mid-tier, and they had the end layers. And when I understood that, I said, yeah, but why not try to make something like that with CloudFront? So I tried, I had a lot of discussion with the Amazon people here to try to use only the S3 buckets for that. And at the end, the only thing I was able to do was to use an EC2 instance. So, but I guess if you have access with other CDN providers and you are able to add EC2 instances in between, it will help same. The only problem if you start to have storage with someone, CDN with Amazon, and CDN with Akamai, let's say, and EC2 instances with Amazon, it starts to be the cost. Because suddenly your internet traffic, or your bandwidth traffic cost, will just jump to the roof. And that was one of our big problems with Akamai, was that we didn't want, each time we needed to push all our files to their storage, net storage, or I don't remember the name, we had to pull everything out from S3. We have everything in S3 anyway. So we needed to pull out from S3 and put in their storage. And actually, the cost of transferring these files was really high compared to transferring the same files to CloudFront or inside the, let's say, the Amazon ecosystem.
Was that an Amazon cost, or
cost or Akamai cost?
Amazon cost. Everything you pull out from Amazon to something that's not Amazon.
So to conclude, whatever outbound traffic that's happening from one Amazon to Akamai is charged. Then when you go to CloudFront, it is not chargeable.
It's charged, but less. I don't like the price of Amazon is so complicated. Never, you can never predict anything anyway. you just take the credit card from your CFO and say you will see the bill at the end of the month and that's it.
And then more than 50 times we drop the price so he stays happy and the CFO stays happy.
Yeah,
so I'm just gonna get that in.
And then we have some talks and you drop the price even more. And
so you have you will be deploying the mid tier with all the regions. Using the Route 53 to connect and
Route. Yeah, so we didn't use all region because there are some that are of no interest to us business wise, but we have like most of them, like east and west coast of US, Australia, Singapore, in a few months India, and Frankfurt and Dublin. So it's almost like we didn't have China at all, and like the center of the US neither, because like East and West Coast covers pretty enough for us.
Okay, just to see a little bit what it helped us, and that was, I did that last year,
because my business people needed proof that I wasn't working on something useless. So that was only for customers coming from India. So you see that they are going Mumbai, Chennai, a little bit of Singapore edge. So here we have the CloudFront edges on the left side. And all these three edges are going, that's luckily, or I don't know, they're all going to the Singapore EC2 instance, because it happened like that. Perhaps sometimes Mumbai, some days could go to the Frankfurt instance. And if you see at the hit and miss ratio, you see that CloudFront has a 70-30 hit ratio, which is, it's really bad.
Yeah, I was going to ask how that compared to Akamai.
Akamai is better. So they are able to store longer the data, but you pay for it. They're a bit more expensive. If you can talk them to have the price down if you want. It's, if you're good talking, they pull the price down.
How large total file size on the edge are you looking at? Are you talking about?
One file is between like 200K and 6 megs. And one segment.
And how many of those? Right,
that's 4,000, around 4,000 for like all rendition for one movie. Sorry. And then like I don't even remember how much movie we have now.
Yeah, I'm curious to know like how much you have on the edge
like
at 3 or 4
terabytes on S3, something like that. And I think our CloudFront monthly is around 60, 70 terabytes, something like that. I'm not even sure it's the right numbers. I'm not even sure I'm allowed to tell them.
So by doing this, right, you mentioned one problem earlier when you're using the directly CloudFront. You're having an issue of some of the files actually automatically is removed some other files.
I didn't solve that.
Still the problem with this.
I didn't solve that with CloudFront, no. But CloudFront is able to pull quicker from wherever he has to pull from, so that it's less an issue. But it's still there. And then you see here what still needs to go to the S3 bucket. Like it's peanuts, it's almost no traffic anymore. So that was just like data on 3 days on the whole content. So it's not like just I pinpointed the good content. But it was just data on a short period of time. But I guess if you make the time longer, it would be about the same numbers. Okay, so how can we still improve that? So the S3 replication that came out a few months back would already help. So it means that we could have our data in Virginia and Singapore at the same time with a replication that's automatic, so that the EC2 instance doesn't have to pull from the other side of the world every time. You can pull to an S3 bucket that's nearer. So you, again, win a little bit of time. Obviously, EFS will help a lot, so we can have more EC2 instances sharing the same cache. always it's for failover. Like if now if I have only one instance that does that, if the instance fails for some reason, I'm kind of screwed and have this weird call in the middle of the night. And one other thing I was thinking while doing this line actually was that why to reply to creation, why pull directly from S3 to localhost? Why not call directly with my curl command on my server the CloudFront edge from where the request came from? So instead of just adding the file to my local EC2 instance, at the same time in one call, I will add it to my local instance and to the CloudFront edge, because the customer will probably go to the same CloudFront edge for the next segment. Yeah, that's the end.
Okay, we have about 3.5 minutes for questions, ish. And if you don't have questions now, you can finish earlier and keep drinking beer. Okay, well, I'm going to stand there, so don't please wait. I forgot to bring my...